it going.
Sure. Yeah, thank you, Whitney. And Whitney, thanks to you and Kathy for, and Diane for putting this together so well. Again, you know, we're not in person, but I think it's the next best thing, you know, just to see everybody on screen. So I welcome all who are participating, and I know that others will be joining us, but this is to inform and recognize partners in the community. And we hope to be at a closer in-person event, not in not too distant future. We have some elected officials who have signed up today, and I want to welcome Senator Sue Serino, Dutchess County Executive Mark Molinaro, Dutchess County Sheriff Kirk Imperati, Robin Lois, Dutchess County Controller, Judge Jeffrey Martin from the Dutchess County Family Court, Steve Caswell, Dutchess County Legislator, Tony Diaquani, Dutchess County Legislator, Rob Rollison, our mayor in the city of Poughkeepsie, and Loretto Brunello, town of Wappingers Falls assessor. And thanks to our many community partners in attendance, too many to mention all by name, but I can't tell you how much we appreciate seeing people on this call, people who support us throughout the year. Before we begin, I just can't help but ask that we join in prayers and support for the people of Ukraine who we learned today are undergoing such horror and strife.
So Brian, I want to apologize to you and folks. I need to unshare and reshare. The other PowerPoint keeps popping back up. So apologize to folks.
Fine. Well, as we said, we miss seeing everyone around the lunch table, but, you know, very thankful that well over 100 people have joined our virtual report to the community today. Well, 2021 was yet another challenging year for family services, but I found inspiration throughout the year. Our community continued to work together to meet the needs of our neighbors. Family services staff continued valiantly to find innovative ways to engage clients through virtual programming where needed, but also providing as much safe in-person programming as possible. And of course, I'm continually inspired by the resilience of the people that we provide services to, the families, children, and individuals who face some of the greatest challenges of our time. So throughout it all, we never lost our vision of a Hudson Valley where everyone has the opportunity to lead their best lives, even in a pandemic. Before we share the many accomplishments of family services in 2021 and what we are looking forward to in 2022, I'm going to take this opportunity to introduce our board chair for family services, Freddie Garcia.
I do. Thanks, Brian, for the introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Freddie Garcia, and it's an honor to serve as the board chair of Family Services. And I welcome you to our report to the community. Since 1879, we have devoted our mission of bringing people together, improving lives, and building stronger and safer communities. We are living through unprecedented times and moments. But what continues to give me hope as we go through this is how we come together, how we continue to support each other, engage with each other, and strengthen each other. I want to thank first and foremost our board, who have been consistent in supporting the work of family services, but also that of the community. And I'm sure many of you are familiar with the individuals and the people serving on our board. You know, I've been on the board for almost 10 years now, and I can honestly say that it is a true masterclass of how you lead an organization and a community. And so I like to thank all those individuals who've helped me kind of see the truth and see the different ways in which you can participate and engage with one another. I also like to thank Brian and the staff, the amazing staff that we have at Family Services, for working tirelessly to meet the needs of the community and our neighbors. Really trying to not only be there, but support and allow things not to repeat, right? And so I really wanna thank our staff, Brian, the team, for all they do. And lastly, I'd like to thank all of you for not only being here, but believing in us. It certainly takes a village to get a lot of the work done, and all of you have played a role in one way or another. So I really appreciate you being here. It means a lot to me, means a lot to.
Freddie, in an effort to mute folks, you accidentally got muted yourself. So if you could unmute, that would be helpful. Thank you, Freddie.
Not sure where I left off. So I'm repeating something. My apologies, folks. But I like to thank our sponsors, our leadership sponsor, Nuvance Health, and our mission sponsor, iHeart Media. Your consistent support is greatly appreciated, and we sincerely thank you for that. We are certainly delighted to be joined by Peter Kelly, president of Vassar Brothers Medical Center, part of Nuvance Health. Mr. Kelly is a seasoned healthcare professional and leader who assumed the presidency role back in August of 2020 amidst the pandemic. Prior, he was the president of Putnam Hospital. And before introducing him to center stage, I really wanna send a huge thank you to Mr. Kelly and all our healthcare professionals for all they have done for us in our community. When things got harder, they jumped in even stronger. And so I'd like to take this moment to thank Mr. Kelly, our healthcare professionals, for all that they do, not only these past few years, but all they do every day. So Mr. Kelly, thanks for joining us today.
Well, thank you very much, Freddie. And thank you for your kind words. And when somebody says he's a seasoned healthcare professional, that just means he's old. So, but thank you for those kind words. I have been in healthcare for a long time prior to coming to Vassar and to Putnam. I was spent most of my career in Manhattan in facilities there. So, but I offer that as a backdrop simply because nobody in healthcare ever expected to see a pandemic, the likes of which we went through over the last 2 years and still are not out of the woods yet. And Vassar has, as I think, stood very strong and proud, and I'm very proud of our staff to provide the service they provided to the community through the pandemic, and looking forward, quite frankly, to providing services in a more normalized fashion as we move ahead. We've done a lot here at Vassar. As you pointed out, during the height of the pandemic, it was not unusual for us to have almost 50% of our patient population of almost 300 patients, over 300 patients, being COVID positive. So the effort that the staff put forth, the pressure that the staff was under, and the way they performed is really, really amazing. And I think that also applies to all of the community services, because it wasn't just in hospitals that COVID patients would take care of, it was in the communities and the homes. And it really was something that's a tribute to everybody that's on this call right now for the efforts that you put forth. Specifically, Vassar, we did, in spite of the pandemic, we moved all of our adult inpatient services into our new pavilion. Did that in January of 2021. And it was something that was amazing because we moved almost 300 patients over a period of 24 hours from one facility to the other and didn't lose a patient. And it really is a tribute to the planning that our staff put forth to achieve that. Again, we've been busy, but we've not lost sight of our overall mission, and that is to grow and expand healthcare services that we provide to our community. So even in the height of the pandemic, we were looking at what are the opportunities to provide better care in our community, not just at the hospital, but through ambulatory services also. One of the big factors in moving here was moving into our new emergency department. And I'll be the first one to say that moving into a new emergency department was not easy. The traffic was busy. We were learning a new facility, and everything didn't work perfectly for the first couple of months. What I'm pleased to say now, though, is I think we have a team that is working in concert and really providing outstanding services to our community in terms of emergency care. The care is high quality. We have excellent practitioners. We move patients through as quickly as we and safely as we possibly can. And our goal is to make sure that we improve those services every day and every week in the coming years, because emergency services clearly are really important to this community. The other thing that I'm really pleased to let everybody know that after over a two-year hiatus, we will be reinstituting pediatric inpatient care here at Vassar Brothers Medical Center. We are working with Connecticut Children's Medical Center in Hartford to provide both hospitalists as well as specialists in the community, which our community-based pediatricians are looking forward to in terms of specialty pediatric care. And our plan right now is once we get fully staffed that we will be reopening the inpatient unit in April of this year, so a mere month and a half away. And ideally, if things keep going well with the surge, we'll have an opportunity to invite people in person to see this new facility. It will be a 9-bed facility with 24/7, 365 hospitalists, trained pediatric hospitalists covering that care, as well as trained staff in the emergency room. So I think that reinstituting and bringing back the pediatric care that this community so badly needs here at Vassar has been a top priority for us. And we will be instituting that again in April of this year. And I think the most important thing that we've done, and this really goes to the community, is we have instituted what's called our community care team. This is something that was piloted at Danbury Hospital in Danbury, which is part of the new Vance system, and we learned from that. And we have our community care director, Ali Hussein, is working with community providers like yourselves to really identify what the purpose of this program is to look at those individuals who are coming to our emergency room day after day, week after week, who not only need medical care we can provide, but once they leave the ED, the community services, the communication, the linkage to the community services is simply not there. And that results in these individuals coming back again to the ED for care here. Many look at them, they have terms like frequent flyers, which I really do not care for. These are people who are in need of care. They're in need of not just medical treatment, but social services. And the program we put in place now and what Ali will be spearheading is really developing the linkages with many of the services that provided by individuals on this phone, on this call rather, so that in fact, when these individuals come in, we have the ability to provide the linkages, the social services and the outpatient medical services to these individuals to help them on the road to recovery, not simply have a revolving door coming back to emergency rooms all the time. We've already enrolled over 30 individuals in this program, and it's only been in place for the last several months. Our goal over the next year is to enroll approximately 100 individuals in this program, and it will work only because we have the linkages with community-based providers like everyone on this call. So I don't want to take up too much more time. There's just a lot going on at Vassar. It's not just a new building, it's really the services we provide, because the bricks and mortar only provide someplace for the services to be in. It's really providing the service in the community, and that's what our goal is. So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to you. Thank you.
Wonderful. Peter, thank you so much for joining us today and for everything that you and your team have been doing at New Vance Health and of course at Vassar Brothers Medical Center, our local hospital here. It's really quite wonderful what you all have been able to accomplish. Brian, I'd like to invite you back into the Zoom room to pick up here.
You bet. Thank you, Peter. And I'm particularly enthusiastic about those linkages that you were referring to. And we're very eager to work with you and Ali in seeing to it that those linkages are successful. It's such a a very grave need in the community. I am going to take a minute to thank other partners on the call today: Dyson Foundation, Community Foundations of the Hudson Valley, our friends at United Way, Dutchess County Community and Family Services, and Dutchess County Department of Behavioral and Community Health. So thanks to all of you. We could not do the work that we do without our valued partners. Just as people are often surprised to know that we have 13 locations across Dutchess, Orange, and Ulster counties, some are surprised to know that we have 15 different programs at Family Services, each one serving children, adults, and families in unique ways. It's through innovation and effective programming and strong collaborations that we work every day to achieve our mission. That mission being to bring people together and find the support that they need, helping people to improve their lives and communities and building a stronger and safer Hudson Valley. While we're not going to cover each of the programs throughout the agency today, I'm inviting Leah Feldman, Family Services Chief Program Officer, to share a few highlights of how we work to achieve our mission in 2021. Leah?
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Leah Feldman. I'm the Chief Program Officer for Family Services. Thank you so much for being here today and for your support of Family Services and our community. Poughkeepsie and the whole Mid-Hudson Valley is a great place to live, but many of our neighbors face real challenges: behavioral health needs, gun violence, a safe place to go after school, domestic violence, access to critical needs such as food, healthcare, and more. And for over 140 years, Family Services has met the ever-changing needs of our community. And we continue that legacy today by offering innovative programs and collaborating with our community to build a stronger, safer Hudson Valley for all. Today, I have the opportunity to share only a few highlights from around the agency. And it's only the beginning, so I encourage you to learn more by reading our 2021 annual report, which is going to be available on our website soon. Family Services assures access to for all adults to high quality behavioral health centers in 8 locations throughout Dutchess and Ulster counties. Last year, our counseling and medical staff helped nearly 6,000 people find their way towards recovery without stigma. Our dedicated team of therapists and medical staff provided individual and group therapy, psychiatric assessment, and medication management in a year when mental wellness continued to be a struggle for many. While we continue to utilize virtual supports for clients, key behavioral health centers remained open for in-person services to meet the needs of high-risk clients, as well as injection medication needs. Our clients have continuous access to support from day one of the pandemic. While many of our services remain virtual, we received feedback from clients that 82% felt that they had a good relationship with their therapist, and 80% shared that the services they received throughout our 8 centers across Dutchess and Ulster counties helped them to feel better. Throughout 2021, we also made great progress towards renovating and creating trauma-informed spaces for our new Highland and Poughkeepsie Behavioral Health Centers. We know that behavioral health and wellness are impacted by the environments which clients receive treatment, and we are proud to offer a warm and welcoming atmosphere for individuals who turn to us for help. Our new Behavioral Health Center opened in Highland in January, which replaced our New Paul Center. And this year, we will open a brand new Poughkeepsie Behavioral Health Center. In the rendering, you can see that the center is going to offer a beautiful space where clients will receive integrated care as we partner with Sun River Health and Genoa Pharmacy to offer enhanced services for adults in our community. Meeting the needs of youth was critical in 2021, and Family Services was certainly at the forefront of providing City of Poughkeepsie youth with opportunities for engagement. Our goal throughout the year was to give youth a place of belonging where they could continue to develop their creative, athletic, academic, workforce, and social skills, even as our schools, our community, and our world continue to be impacted by COVID. Throughout the spring and summer of 2021, the Family Partnership Center provided classrooms and enrichment spaces for in-person elementary age programming. We had 37 children participating in the school year program and 34 children participating in our summer enrichment activities throughout July and August. Students not only had fun, but they received academic assistance from tutors, recreation opportunities, and plenty of creative arts opportunities as well. In the fall, we made the difficult decision to suspend services for elementary students. For many years, we have had significant challenges finding sustainable funding and stability for these programs. This has only been exacerbated by the pandemic. So we continue to look for opportunities to resume those services for elementary age youth. But in the meantime, we have focused our attention on reaching middle and high school age youth through our Teen Resource Activity Center. And this year was 2021 was an exciting year for our Teen Resource Activity Center track. We opened our newly renovated track center, which provides a trauma-informed, bright, and welcoming safe space for teens to come every day after school. Middle and high school students not only have access to recreation, mentoring, homework help, and workshops that increase life skills, but they now also have access to our state-of-the-art music studio, where they are creating their own music and podcasts, and most importantly, sharing their voices. In the fall, we enhanced our track program by aligning with Family Services SNUG program with the recognition of the significant toll that gun violence has had on youth in Poughkeepsie. We have restructured the team to include two full-time youth outreach workers and a supervisor to further develop relationships with vulnerable youth, increase gun and gang violence prevention efforts, and mediate conflicts, all with the goal of reducing violence in the lives of youth in our community and providing support to youth and families who've experienced violence. At the start of this year, our youth outreach workers began partnering with Poughkeepsie Middle and High School during the day, working with school staff to identify youth most at need of an individualized and ongoing services. After school, our SNUG team provides a safe passage for students to reach their next destination, many of whom make that destination our track center. One of our track youth said it best when they shared, "Everyone is like family here." And that is our goal, to create a safe place of belonging where youth can have access to the support and resources that they deserve. Our family programs provide critical support to stabilize families and ensure child safety. From parenting education to supervised visitations, we meet families where they are in order to promote growth and healing in the family. Our family education programs in Ulster and Orange counties are tailored to each individual and include both group and in-home support. Our staff have been creative throughout the pandemic in our efforts to meet the needs of children and families, whether it's been through in-person programming in our office, visits in local parks, or providing families with take-home activities, including baking fun and family game nights that promote a nurturing environment. In 2021, 399 parents and children at risk of abuse and neglect received services, reaching a total of 103 families. At Family Services, we are always looking for ways to better strengthen families, as this is at the core of what we do. And in 2021, we launched the Enhanced Parenting Time Program with our collaborative partners in Ulster County, including the Court and the Department of Social Services. Enhanced Parenting Time provides critical parenting education and supervised visitation services to families experiencing substance use disorders who are referred by Ulster County Family Treatment Court. In this free program for families, parents and children receive two visits per week for 2 hours each. Families receive help with transportation and enjoy activities such as grocery shopping together and then preparing a family meal to enjoy during their visit. The program has helped families by providing bedding, furniture, and home goods so that children have a warm and welcoming environment upon their return home. In just 6 months, the program provided 114 parenting time sessions to 5 parents and 7 children, helping families move to less restrictive levels of care and supervision and helping children transition home to the care of their parents while also supporting parents through their recovery and parenting journey. At Family Services, we understand that in order to create a stronger, safer community, we need to work diligently to prevent many of the challenges facing our community. We are a regional leader in programming that increases individuals' awareness and coping skills to reduce sexual violence and substance use. And we have been so excited to get back into the classroom in 2021, providing the important support and skill development that youth need. Through our Ulster Prevention Council, UPC, we work to prevent substance use throughout Ulster County, whether it's through prevention programming in the schools or working alongside community leaders through community coalitions and events. At the start of 2021, lessons were provided in the virtual classroom, and teachers, students, and staff were thrilled when prevention educators were able to return to the classroom in person this fall. Nearly 600 students participated in the Too Good for Drugs programming. In addition to classroom programs, UPC worked with the Department of Health to engage youth in creating their own substance use prevention messages. With guidance from our staff, youth developed an original media campaign, which was teens sharing with other teens about where they can turn for help if they're stressed, struggling with substance use, and need someone to talk to. Additionally, our new Teen Intervene program is there for youth and families when they need help, providing support for teenagers who are experiencing mild to moderate problems associated with alcohol and other drugs, with the goal of helping teens reduce and eliminate their substance use. As you all know, in a time where youth are in great need, transitioning back to life in the classroom, this support has been invaluable to youth and to school personnel. Despite the pandemic, our regional sexual violence prevention programming has been focused on creating a healthy school life and healthy nightlife throughout Hudson Valley. Within the Healthy School Life Initiative, middle schoolers engage in the Shifting Boundaries curriculum, where they learn how to define their personal boundaries and what to do if someone crosses their boundaries. After participating in our program, 98% of students reported that they know the steps to take if someone violates their boundaries. High school and college students participate in the Mentors in Violence Prevention, where they learn what it means to be an active bystander in confronting violence, and also discusses hard to talk about issues such as gender-based violence. Additionally, to create a healthier nightlife and help stop sexual violence before it happens, staff are working with alcohol-serving establishments. Studies show that sexual violence increases within nightlife due to alcohol consumption, as well as societal gender norms that surround the bar scene. And so the Safer Bars program has helped bar staff recognize the signs of when something doesn't look right and how they can intervene safely to help keep the patrons safe. We encourage everyone to visit our new saferhudsonvalley.com website. There you will find a variety of what would you do animation scenarios that test your knowledge on bystander intervention. So far, our team has developed 6 animated bystander intervention videos, and they have had incredible success on social media with 195,000 Facebook and 151,000 Instagram impressions. Our community safety programs. So Family Services works with individuals who have a history of gun-related violence or domestic violence in relationships to help them learn a healthier approach to the people in their lives and communities. Our programs look at how belief systems and personal histories can lead to violence and give individuals the knowledge and skills to make the changes in their lives that make our communities safer. In 2021, our community safety programs reached over 2,000 individuals and community members. This was primarily through our SNUG program, as the team got back into the community for in-person events, neighborhood gatherings, and helping reduce gun violence in our community. Our SNUG team works to reduce gun violence by mediating conflicts with individuals who are at the highest risk of shooting someone or being shot. The team of outreach workers, social workers, and case managers work together to respond to shooting incidents, reduce potential gun violence, support families and neighborhoods, and ensure victims have access to the support they need. In 2021, the team conducted 81 mediations of violence and had 561 hours of canvassing in the community. Sadly, our community had several incidents of fatal gun violence last year. In the face of community tragedy, our SNUG team has cultivated unprecedented support from community members, politicians, and local leaders. SNUG shooting responses have galvanized the community to share in our message to reduce gun violence, and there has been an outpouring of support locally and within the state with hope for a brighter future ahead. SNUG is in the community making change, whether it's hosting seminars for minority and women-owned businesses, helping participants better understand their finances, hosting community canvassing days, working with participants in the new music studio, organizing a step class, or hosting Saturday open gyms. SNUG is connecting with our neighbors, ensuring that we build a safer community. In victim services, COVID-19 created an even greater crisis for victims, as many were isolated at home with the very people who hurt them. COVID further isolated victims of domestic violence, sexual assault, and child abuse. And throughout 2021, our Center for Victim Safety and Support helped survivors reconnect, find safety, and seek justice. In 2021, we helped 2,368 victims find support. That includes 262 adult and victim and child victims of sexual violence and nearly 2,000 adult and child victims of domestic violence. Additionally, being able to provide critical emergency assistance to survivors was paramount in 2021. And we are proud that we were able to help 24 families stay safe in their home by helping with rent and utilities, even helping to install safety features such as cameras and locks, And moreover, the team helped five parents and their children relocate to safer homes. Launched during the pandemic, our Youth Witness to Violence program continues to grow, serving youth and caregivers who witness violence, both domestic violence and community violence, through group therapy. The program received 84 referrals in 2021, highlighting the need for programming that addresses the impact of violence on our youngest neighbors. Victims services staff also hosted many in-person education and outreach events in 2021. In April, staff collaborated with local libraries to offer support and resources to victims of sexual violence. In September, we hosted our National Day of Remembrance for Homicide Victims. During October's Domestic Violence Awareness Month, the program hosted multiple events, including training for law enforcement on victim-centered investigations, the Purple Light Project, where staff distributed 1,200 purple light bulbs across Dutchess County to show support for victims of domestic violence, and our 11th annual Walk a Mile event, where 200 people took a stand against sexual and domestic violence. And finally, in December, staff were delighted to partner with the Arlington Professional Firefighters to coordinate the adoption of 81 families and 138 children to lift the spirits of survivors during the holidays. Thank you for joining us in celebrating the many ways we've been successful in the past year and remaining with us as we continue to confront the many challenges still to face. All could not be done without the incredible and amazing work of our staff. Please join me in recognizing all that they do for the community, tirelessly working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, supporting our friends, families, and neighbors. Thank you.
Leah, thank you so much for sharing all of the good work that is happening across the agency. It's, you know, when I hear it all at once, I'm just astounded, of course, but certainly inspired as well. And I thank you and all of our leadership team members at Family Services, as well as all of the staff, who, whether they're in the front lines or in the back office in finance or HR, in those support functions, all make our mission come alive. Every member of our staff work diligently to ensure that everyone has, you know, the opportunity to lead their best lives. But, you know, it's not just dedicated staff who share our vision. It is all of you on the Zoom today and many others in the community. And when I think about a vision of what can be, what comes to my mind is the Family Partnership Center. As many of you know, our beloved Family Partnership Center is a 107-year-old building that is the heart of the city of Poughkeepsie. Inside of its walls, amazing things happen every day. But the building itself invites us to re-envision what is possible. We're lucky to be working with innovative and visionary partners in the community about how we can transform the Family Partnership Center to a warmer and more welcoming environment for the entire community. One of our partners is Mass Design Group. Mass Design Group is a nonprofit architectural firm. Actually, it was recently highlighted on 60 Minutes. Its founder and chief executive officer, Michael Murphy, is a native of Poughkeepsie, and I invite you to take a few minutes and watch this special message from Michael, who sends his best wishes to us all.
He said, "You're doing all this work in Haiti and Rwanda. When are you going to come back to your hometown and work with us in Poughkeepsie? We need a lot of help."
Poughkeepsie, like many once thriving industrial cities, has seen factories close. It's downtown choked off by highways, its storefronts boarded up. To top it off, its creek flooded during Hurricane Irene.
We had just been in one of the most rural places in the world, and we had seen a hospital change the economy. I said, why can't we do that same thing here in Poughkeepsie?
So Mass opened a small office on Main Street and got to work.
Yeah. Radiant light coming off of there.
Converting the city's old trolley barn into an art space and designing housing. It's helping turn this old building into a food hall.
We're going to save this building.
And converting this long abandoned factory into a new headquarters for the environmental group Scenic Hudson.
If you look up, you can see that this whole opening was once a window.
That was a window?
That was all a window.
Oh my goodness. I'm Michael Murphy from Poughkeepsie, New York, and just I can't be more thrilled about really anything than being able to work with you all and work in our fair city. In many ways, your organization and Brian in particular really made that happen and changed my life and the trajectory of our organization. When I was working in Rwanda and Haiti after architecture school, I got an email. I was in Haiti, actually got an email from Brian saying, when are you going to come back and work in our hometown? We need support here, and you're welcome anytime. And by the way, the Family Partnership Center needs a lot of support itself, being recently hit by Hurricane Irene. It was one of those emails that makes you rethink what you're doing and kind of charged me to think about other places in you know, places that I knew, places that we may not have been working in anew in a fresh way. So quickly after that, I was over the winter time, drove up during a snowstorm, got to tour the old building where my father went to high school in when it was Lord's, and see it with fresh eyes. You know, Poughkeepsie, going to Poughkeepsie High School, growing up there, not only is a place I love, but it was also a place that I was told that urban planners and designers and architects had destroyed and demolished. That story it was kind of planted in my head 20 years ago. And I can't say it was a direct route, but it's one of the reasons I definitely sought the disciplines of design as a profession, not just to see why that was, but how the disciplines of design could be shaped to fight for something other than destruction and division, but potentially for healing, for creating places of common good, of rethinking our public square under the needs of places that have been disinvested and communities that have been marginalized. The Family Partnership Center is so unique in that it brings all of these public services together. It needs to be a place that's welcoming and warm, that people feel is their own, that threshold between the very anxiety-filled and discordant public and the institutions that we need to serve us in order to get basic fundamental services of care, of mental health, of education, of food, that those are not frightening and anxiety-filled experiences, but those are ones of warmth and welcoming and opportunity and shared amenities. Obviously, you all are doing that every day in that building and trying through your shared programs and initiatives to fight for those communities, those individuals that have been most marginalized often, sometimes the most in the cracks between other systems. This is a crucial public space to provide a net for those that often fall through the cracks, but also a public amenity for all of us to admire. We hope that new entryway starts to create that new narrative as well, a public space for the whole community. I hope you all have a wonderful meeting. I hope you all have a wonderful discussion about what's possible. I hope you're able to celebrate the incredible work of family services, but also why a space like the Partnership Center is so necessary. How the work you do is God's work, supporting those communities that need them the most. And I just want to thank you for allowing us to serve and to giving us a reason to come home.
Thank you, Michael. And thank you to our Poughkeepsie Mass Design Group partners, Chris Kroner, Evelina Knodel, and Justin Brown, who have been working so closely with us over the past many months and years, actually. I truly do appreciate all of that you are doing with us and for us. having a strong community center, I believe, is essential in meeting the needs of our neighbors and in building resilience within the city and the community. The Family Partnership Center, as I said before, is the heart of the city of Poughkeepsie, and I believe it's a source of hope and resiliency for 70,000 people per year. And it's hard to get a grasp on that number, because when you have 22 partner agencies, it's really difficult to do headcounts. But I think, you know, one of those headcounts was 70,000, but we think more. You know, we've never before seen just how important it is to have a critical community center than we have seen in these past 2 years. The Family Partnership Center and the dedicated partner agencies who make up this special building have worked really hard to meet community needs and have done so successfully by remaining open all throughout the pandemic. For instance, Sun River Health provided vaccines and healthcare to keep our community healthy. Dutch's Outreach provided food for families and clothing for children. Dutch's Community College helped neighbors reach their educational goals. And the many organizations that serve youth throughout the Family Partnership Center, including Family Services, Real Skills Network, Finish Strong for Wellness, the Boys and Girls Club Poughkeepsie Performing Arts Academy, and Rebuilding Our Children and Community, all work to build resilience with our community's youth and support families during what seemed like never-ending days. And we found it so important that while students were essentially exiled from one another, with schools having to be closed and remote learning put in place, that we provide an opportunity, a space where people could still be safe and at the same time socialize with their friends. You know, the Family Partnership Center is not only home to services for those who need support, it's also a gathering space for our community. This past summer, for instance, we had a mural dedication to Tree Arrington. Community members, family, friends came together to share their memories of Tree and how he so successfully and powerfully impacted their lives and the lives of so many Poughkeepsie City youth for so many years through Real Skills. We were treated to an original poem by poet Gold Wilkerson titled Hoodlum Prophet that so captured who Tree was. I really invite you to stop by the Family Partnership Center lobby if you haven't recently and take a look at this other beautiful mural by Nestor Natalingoitia. In the fall, we had drive-through trick-or-treat for families at the Family Partnership Center and a resource fair in the gym. Over the holidays, Family Services and partners throughout the Partnership Center hosted holiday events. And as a matter of fact, we have a picture here with Family Partnership Center steward, Tanisha Casellas, with Sheriff Kirk Emperati and other members of the Sheriff's Office who provided toys and food to over 100 families this holiday season. And that was just one of the many initiatives that helped families, services, and the Family Partnership Center smile this holiday. Coming up in March, Family Partnership Center will host another community job fair. We invite organizations throughout our community to join us and share community and career opportunities. So there are currently 22 partner organizations inside the Family Partnership Center, from healthcare, education, arts, medical care, social services. And our partners work together, creating through collaboration, efficiencies, while weaving a stronger network of support than if each organization had a location on their own. By providing our community with, you know, just this one location where people can come for numerous services, we make the process of seeking support simple and dignified. We're excited to share that this year, we're going to welcome two new partners to the Family Partnership Center. And this is so important in my view. The brand new Sadie Peterson Delaney African Roots Library now will be under the Poughkeepsie Library District. And the Library District has worked hard to take the African Roots Library that's been here and volunteer run for the past 15 years and actually bring it to a new level of life as a resource to the community. And I'm talking about the importance of this because I think we sometimes think of the Family Partnership Center as simply, you know, a place where people can get services or get food, all of which is very important. But for instance, in the library, think of this, a returning father can take advantage of a library where he can nurture his child in ways that may not have been all too familiar, where he and his son read together and explore the world of literature related to their own heritage. That is so profound and so important. That library will be reopening in April during the National Library Week. And soon, the nonprofit Heritage Federal Credit Union will provide banking and other financial services to the north side of Poughkeepsie and beyond. And what does that mean? It means that, for instance, a domestic abuse survivor escaping a life of violence may often need a means toward financial independence, establishing their first bank account, their checking account, for the first time ever, after surviving what had been a long period of control and abuse. This is incredibly important to me, to us, that through the 22 partner organizations, as I said, we reach at least 70,000 people a year with 110,000 and more interactions. There was a study of the Family Partnership Center that showed that 50% of visitors utilize between 2 and 5 services, and 20% use 6 or more services inside the building. That's powerful impact. According to the Benjamin Center at SUNY New Paltz, for every dollar spent on services at the Family Partnership Center, that translates into $72 worth of positive social impact in our community and reduced costs to municipalities and taxpayers. In addition, the Benjamin Center found that the Family Partnership Center contributes $15.5 million of economic activity and 146 jobs in New York State. And yet, as vital as the work of the Family Partnership Center is, one of the most important sites where work takes place is strengthening. And unless we address significant structural and other vital capital needs, the Family Partnership Center will quickly become unusable and services will be without a home, impacting thousands of our neighbors in the city of Poughkeepsie, throughout Dutchess County and the Hudson Valley as a whole. So what are we doing to help this? Well, we've launched our Standing Together, Standing Strong campaign for the Family Partnership Center. Through this campaign, we're making critical investments in a space that allows us to come together and lift each other up, build strong community relationships, and make sure that everyone has the opportunity to lead their best lives. You know that over the past several years, we had to install a new boiler. We renovated the gym quite successfully into a space that is now so inviting and, you know, reflecting the respect that the kids deserve. Some other initial projects include replacing the roof, remaking the front entryways, and installing new auditorium windows. These changes are just the beginning of an essential process to protect the Family Partnership Center's long-term sustainability. When it's complete, The center will be fortified to serve thousands more families in the years to come. So we've raised nearly $5 million to support our $9.1 million campaign. This has included government funds, foundation and business support, individual donations from our community, our generous board of directors and campaign steering committee. And the largest philanthropic gift Family Service has ever received from the Dyson Foundation, to whom we are so grateful. As I said, New York State, Dutchess County, the City of Poughkeepsie have pledged support, along with numerous other foundations, trusts, generous individuals, and businesses. They're all pitching in. We're grateful for friends who believe in the power of the Family Partnership Center and the partnerships that take place within to create change in our community and to help people find the strength within themselves to lead a better life. We would love to invite you all to join the movement to ensure that this old building is viable for generations to come. It was built in 1914 and originally served as the city's high school, and then went on to serve as Our Lady of Lourdes. When the Family Partnership Center opened in 1997, the building was already 80 years old. Over time, deferred maintenance has occurred as we focused on providing critical services. But just as your home needs updating, so does a building of this magnitude. You know, we've been asked the question, why this building? Why not move the Family Partnerships into a newer building or build something new? Well, there's a few reasons, and they are pretty clear. The Family Partnership Center is a resource of unprecedented collaboration and co-location right here in the heart of Poughkeepsie and in the heart of so much and so great a need in Poughkeepsie. It's a convenient and walkable location for many of our neighbors, as transportation can be a challenge for our clients. They can access numerous resources in one trip. Also, there's not another suitable building available to buy or even a large enough building lot in central Poughkeepsie. We also talked early on to a local architect firm, and they confirmed that the Family Partnership Center has what's referred to as good bones, and that the cost of maintaining and improving the current building is more economically sound than new construction, especially right now. So the work has already begun. This winter, staff and clients are warm and dry thanks to a complete replacement of the Family Partnership Center roof, as well as the roof of the gymnasium and the auditorium. Our thanks to Frank Algier and the team at Vanguard Roofing who put that new roof on. In addition, brick pointing by Maya Construction started in the fall and will finish up as the weather warms up. We look forward to bringing the 1,000-seat auditorium back to life and hosting theater, productions, and lots of other things that need a lot of attention, stage curtain and lighting among them. We've also got to address years of water damage and wear in our front entrance and lobby. The stairs are literally crumbling. Through this campaign, we are going to provide the warm welcome our clients and community deserve. A brand new entryway that is fully accessible, and it includes a glass pavilion that encompasses a versatile community room and a brand new elevator that will make that accessible for people using wheelchairs or strollers or whatever other challenges they have. And the work won't end there. After critical structural projects are addressed, we're going to turn our attention to even more projects, including window replacement, bathroom renovations, asbestos abatement, new lighting and doors. We're excited to share the architect rendering of the beautiful new space to come. Thanks to our partners again at Mass Design, we have a beautiful new space plan for our community. And we're looking forward to inviting to our grand groundbreaking when we come to that at hopefully this spring. And then it will go throughout the rest of the year. At a moment when we've just been reminded how important community institutions are, our Standing Together, Standing Strong campaign. It's a great opportunity for us to come together, to find new ways to support each other and build the infrastructure for everyday impact, so we are ready when the next crisis comes. So we've thrown a lot of information at you today, and I hope you've been able to absorb and appreciate it. And we want to take the remaining time to answer a few questions from our attendees. We're not going to unmute participants, but would like participants to write their questions into the chat, and I'll ask Whitney to read the questions as they come in.
Yeah, so thank you, Brian. I really want to give you and Leah so much credit for sharing the great work of our community and our agency. Invite you to put your questions in the chat. I've got an eye on that, but also want to let you know I recognize we are close to our end time. And so myself, Brian, other members of our leadership team will actually hang on to Zoom for a little bit longer. And if you are able to hang on with us, we'd love to answer your questions. But in the meantime, if you do have a question, I invite you to put those in the chat, and we'd love to take those. So as we wait for folks to either ask questions or put them in the chat, Brian, I'm interested, when are you expecting that we might see the first shovel go in the ground for our front entryway? I know it's something I'm really excited about, and we're waiting for warm weather, but what's that timeline look like for our front entryway?
Well, we're expecting the contractor's bids to come to us on March 9th. So we'll open the bids then, and then I will be reviewing them along with Natalie, our CFO, and several board members who are part of an ad hoc committee to look over those bids and decide the direction that we'll be taking. And then hopefully, as soon as the weather permits, we'll be in the ground. There's of course a lot of staging and ordering of materials that needs to be done and signing contracts and such, but I'm expecting that we'll be in the ground pretty darn soon.
Well, that's great, Brian. I know I was so inspired by the Mass Design Group rendering of what the front entryway is going to look like. And I know I cannot wait until it's complete and we can all gather as a community, hopefully by the end of the year, perhaps. I know others on the call are excited to see that too. Truly, we invite you to come to the Partnership Center. If you haven't been in a while, come visit us. We love to share the good work that's happening at the FPC, and of course, would love to share with you the plans for how this building is growing and changing in order to better meet the needs of our community. Just want to recognize we're at one, and I know that some folks have to hop off and get to other meetings, but want to extend the invitation for those who are able to remain on. If you do have questions you want to ask, again, we're going to hang on just a little bit longer to be able to answer those questions that you do have. So feel free to either put them in the chat or hang on with us, and we can have more of an open discussion.
Whitney, one question that came to me a few times is, when will our annual report be available on the website?
Oh, great question, Leah. So we are actually working on that getting loaded up today. And so thank you all for your excitement about it. We're excited to share in even more detail about the good work that happened at Family Services last year. So by the end of today, you're going to be able to find our annual report up on the website. And I invite you to take a look. And please don't feel free to reach out if you'd like a printed copy. We'd be happy to send that out to you as well. We just are very proud of what's happened at Family Services in the last year and want to make sure that everybody has the opportunity to share in the good work with us.
You know, Whitney, I'm putting in the chat my email address if anybody wants to follow up with questions after we're off this Zoom. Okay.
And I see one question in the chat is regarding the auditorium. Can you share more details? Will you be able to handle fully staged productions, dance, concerts?
Oh, that's what we're looking forward to. The first priority has to be the replacement of the crumbling windows. Okay. That's actually a safety issue. And then we have a lot more to look forward to in terms of actual window treatments to darken the room. stage lighting. We have stage lighting now, but it's really old and it really does not serve the purpose. We're going to replace the carpeting, upgrade the seating, repair the plaster, do a lot of painting, refinish the stage floor. So there's a lot of upgrades in the auditorium that we're looking forward to so that we can then really stage full performances. It's pretty well used right now, but you know, when for instance, last year when the Poughkeepsie Performing Arts Academy, after all their rehearsing in the auditorium, they had to go to a different venue for their actual production. So we look forward to being home to those productions and other gatherings as well, you know, community forums, the naturalization ceremony, and so on and so forth.
That's great. And a special shout out to Chris Kroner, again, our friends, local friends from Mass Design Group, who is logging off now, and he wanted to share his energy, optimism, and enthusiasm for the FPC. So thank you, Chris, for being with us today and for all that you're doing with us as well.
So Sabrina Marzuga, who is the commissioner of the Dutchess County Community and Family Services, has asked the question, are there gaps in services that you have identified in the community that we can work on? You know, Leah mentioned earlier that, you know, funding for youth services is very difficult. I have to say, though, that the county has stepped up more and more in terms of providing more funding. And so that's been very helpful. But I think steady, reliable funding is something that we so awfully need. And part of that has to do with some difficulties with the funding models that the New York State Office of Children and Family Services offers, where the reimbursement just does not make sense and does not allow for us to have sustainable programming for elementary school students. And so we're working very hard in advocating with New York State in having them see the sense of changing those funding models. But thank you very much, Sabrina, for asking. And I know that you're always there when we do identify a need to provide the support that you can.
So I love that there are still 52 of us on past 1 o'clock, and certainly we're still here to answer questions. So if you want to throw them in the chat, or as Brian mentioned, we are around afterwards. If there's something you don't want to ask in the chat or that comes to mind later for you, just please know that all of us here at Family Services want to make sure you have all the information that you need, and we'd be happy to talk with you at any time. We love to talk about what we do, if you haven't gotten a sense of that already today.
You know, I have to say one more thing. I said a lot during the whole session, but and Freddie certainly spoke to the dedication of our board of directors, but believe me, from a leadership staff standpoint, our board of directors is so very important in providing us with guidance, advice, direction, all about the mission, and so often, you know, coming to the rescue, you know, in whatever way, if we need a little information here or expertise there, we have a fabulous board of directors, and I would invite people to look at the annual report and see all the fabulous people who do serve on the board.
Well, as people seem to be making their exit to their next meetings, I know Brian and Leah and the entire Family Services team, our board and leadership team, we really want to thank everybody for being with us today. I know I am very excited for next year when we're all together again for lunch and sharing the good work that we know is going to happen in 2022. But we really do appreciate that you have joined us today, that you've spent your lunch hour with us to hear about what's happening at Family Services and what's happening in 2022. We're very excited. And all of you that are part of our Family Services family, we know we can't do it without you. So thank you for being with us at this time.
And thanks again to Peter Kelly and to John Nelson for the support throughout the year. We appreciate that so much and benefit from it so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Okay, be in touch. Take care. Be well.